we're going to go ahead and get started. If we could take our seats. Good morning and welcome to the Education Policy Seminar Series today. My name is Emily Wiseman, I'm a second-year student in the Ed Policy Program. This talk is part of the Education Policy Seminar Series sponsored by the Bankard Fund for the Political Economy. Each semester, Ed Policy Works hosts a number of talks that are free and open to the public. For more information on Ed Policy Works or the next seminar, please visit our website. Today, we are delighted to welcome Dr. Taylor. Eric Taylor is an assistant professor at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. Eric studies the economics of education with a particular interest in employer-employee interactions between schools and teachers, hiring and turnover, job design, training, and performance evaluation. His work has been published in the American Economic Review, the Journal of Human Resources, and the Journal of Public Economics, and featured in Slate, Time, The Washington Post, and Education Week. Eric was a Spencer Dissertation Fellow in 2014 and was recognized for excellence in teaching and mentoring by the Stanford Graduate School of Education in 2013. I've had the privilege of working with Dr. Taylor on a grant proposal this summer, and I'm so grateful that he was able to join us today. Dr. Taylor will be talking for approximately 1 hour and will leave 15 to 30 minutes for discussions or questions. Please note that any additional or personalized questions after 12:30 can be addressed via email, as other meetings will be beginning at this time. Thank you for attending the Education Policy Seminar Series today. Please join us for the next talk.
A very kind introduction. I should take the part about having a teaching award out of my bio. Your expectations are going to be way too high for today. But thank you for having me. It's always a lot of fun to be at UVA. I'm sort of an alum by marriage, so I really have a sort of UVA has a special place in my heart. It's great to be here. We have an hour and a half. Please ask me questions. Stop me and ask me questions during the course of the talk. Coming from economics, as you all well know, if you don't ask me questions, I will assume I'm doing something wrong or you're bored to tears. So even if you don't have questions, come up with something to sort of break up me talking at you for an hour. Other than that, I'll try to leave a little bit of time at the end, too, for those of you who would prefer to save your questions for the end. But I would prefer that you ask me when they come up. Other than that, I guess we'll get started. So this work is, among other great co-authors, joined with John Pepe, who's going to be here next week. So hopefully you'll come hear him talk. He is not talking about this. We did coordinate, at least on that. And broadly speaking, what this paper is about how the performance of individual teachers is affected by the other teachers with whom they work or whom they work around. And in particular, we're interested in this basic question of how workers learn job skills from their coworkers. This is an incredibly long-standing question in economics. And I'm going to argue is particularly relevant for teachers. Why? So first of all, as I suspect most of the people in this room are well aware, there's an enormous amount of now well-documented variation in teacher performance. Differences between teachers that are meaningful and large, and yet we have relatively little understanding of why or how those differences arise. One thing that does seem to be a consistent result is that part of the variation in performance across teachers is a result of learning on the job. So we see large returns to experience in the early years of teaching. That's a pretty consistent result. One quite plausible hypothesis for why there are large returns to experience is that people are learning skills from the other people that they work around. So Fo Jackson and Elias Bridgman, in the paper that is probably closest to this work, study sort of teachers learning from each other in the wild, if you will. So they have a large data set and they study sort of the extent to which working among high-skilled colleagues has effects on your own performance, both in the short run and the long run. And my co-author, John Pape-Nacraft, also sort of shows some evidence that the particular work environment in which you work affects the recurrence. So this is sort of the context that suggests that it's important, that it might be important to understand how people are learning from one another, all of which contrasts the typical way in which we try to help teachers improve once they're on the job, which we sort of lump under the big heading of professional development, where there's relatively little promising empirical evidence that this is a useful topic. So that's the big context. What do we do?
On the big context, it's just sort of a big thought question. If you were to, as I think you should sell this to a broader audience, what other types of work environments do you think are close parallels to teaching in terms of learning from how work works? This is not quite like, I don't know, Scott Page's work on Teams at Google, where the coworkers are producing some idea together. It's more like, I don't want to, you control your own classroom for, I only do it for, 50 minutes twice a week, but, teachers much longer during the day. And then you kind of maybe interact with people in the hallways. What are the other production parallels to think about? If the guy sitting next to you at the call center is more productive or that's too low skill, but what other similar environments could we port this to?
Yeah, it's a great question. You mentioned call centers. There is a little bit of work on call centers, which has sort of shares the feature of my job is my job, and I'm working close to someone who has their job, but that's their job. As you move up the skill distribution to things like some of the more natural comparisons to teaching like nursing, there's just more joint production.
Yeah.
So it's a great question. I don't have a...
The sort of nuts and bolts of the mechanism of stressing you both in terms of time. You don't have to do it in your paper. I think that would be sort of, but just how the interaction is occurring. And yours is a very particular kind of experimental interaction.
Yeah. And it is an experiment, so I'm going to be talking about an experiment, so we're going to sort of externally manipulate the degree or the way in which people are interacting with each other. And so what we assign low-skilled teachers, who I'm going to call target teachers, we're going to assign them to a high-skilled partner who works in the same school. They're going to be matched, as I'll say more about in just a minute, they're going to be matched based on strengths and weaknesses in specific teaching skill areas. And we're gonna ask them to work together over the course of a school year to improve each other's skills. And primarily the results that I'm gonna show you are examining teacher performance as measured by teachers' contributions to student test score.
Just maybe this is gonna be come on down the road, but in terms of distinguishing mechanisms like actually learning skills from your peers versus like psychological mechanisms like motivation and things like this, are you going to be able to sort of measure, evaluate those two different channels in the design?
So I'm going to show you some things about mechanisms. I don't think we have any convincing tests about sort of effort or psychological mechanisms, but I think there are some tests that are relevant to other mechanisms that are convincing. So if other more detailed questions come up when we get there, there are some results that aren't here. I can talk a little bit about them. So if other questions come up when we get to mechanisms, but there will be some about mechanisms. So in fact, here's a preview of a little bit about mechanisms. So what do we find? At the end of the day, we find that performance improves for the target teacher. That is, their students are learning more. In fact, for the target teachers, their kids in the treatment group are learning 0.12 standard deviations more than in math and reading than in the control group. And those improvements appear to persist after the treatment ends, which maybe starts to get at whether this is an effort. improvement or something different. In terms of mechanisms, the primary result that I'm going to talk about is that the evidence suggests that teachers learn from their partners, and the primary result is that that the performance improvements were larger the better was the match between the target teacher and their partner. That is, the better sort of, the more of the skills that the target teacher needed to learn, more of them were matched by the partner teacher, the performance improvements were larger, which is a very particular kind of complementarity in this sort of production of skills for teachers. So I'll say more about that. Okay. So let me just tell you some more details about the setting and treatment. This work, we did this work in the Jackson, Madison County school system in Tennessee, which is sort of a medium-sized district that serves mostly low-income, mostly minority students. And the sample are fourth through eighth grade math and reading teachers, about 136 of them and 3,000 students. The design, the experimental design, is that we randomly assigned schools within blocks, and the blocks were pairs. So we paired up 14 schools into 7 pairs, and we randomly assigned one of the schools to be in treatment and one of the schools to be in control, and then we conducted this sort of pair-up teacher experiment in the treatment schools. The traditional tests show balance on pre-treatment covariates, so we think we have a reasonable experiment. What was the treatment?
Eric, sorry.
Yeah, sorry.
Building on Eric's question, on the data point, do you observe or have data on anything within the partner-target interactions? What they discuss, how long they meet, you know, anything like that, how frequently?
The short answer is no. We tried to collect some of that data, but we're thwarted by practicalities, which I'll save for another day. We do know things, even if we had that data, that would sort of be endogenous. We do know things about the characteristics of the pairs before they got started, and that's what I'm going to leverage later on.
If you're talking about design, so do I understand correctly then that you don't have random variation in the assignment of teachers to matched pairs? So when you talk about seeing larger effects for those who were a better match, as you call them, that's an observational correlation, but not something that you've identified relative to, say, a random match.
But it's very, let me just move to that now. The pairs were not randomly assigned.
Right.
It's driven by an external mechanism. So what did we do? Like I said, the pair is made up of a low-performing target teacher and a high-performing partner who work at the same school. And they're going to be matched using Tennessee's team performance evaluation rubric. These are classroom observations in which teachers are scored on 19 specific skills on a scale from 1 to 5. And we're going to call a target teacher someone who scores lower than 3, which is a very low score, lower than 3, be careful, in one or more skill areas. And their target and their partner is going to be somebody who scores greater than 4 in one or more of those same skill areas. So I'm not quite to your question, Sally, but I'm going to get there very quick. Let me just give you a sense of what these skills in this rubric looks like. Some of you are going to be very familiar with data like this. But here's an example of one of the 19 skills. This one is managing student behavior. So you get scored from 1 to 5. To score perfectly, you have to be doing things like the teacher deals with students who have caused disruptions around the entire class. Teacher attends to disruptions quickly and firmly. At the other end of the scale, teachers who are scoring a 1 are doing things like the teacher cannot distinguish between incorrect behavior and inappropriate behavior. Disruptions frequently interrupt instruction. So that's one example. And we're gonna match teachers on all 19 of these specific skill areas, which range from things like managing student behavior and respectful culture all the way to sort of things like asking questions and providing feedback to students. Well, principals did rate people. It's either principals or other administrators in the school, but sort of half of the observations are done by principals. So you're wondering.
I mean, like, when you know radar effects are enormous, so the map just doesn't like a small difference in the scale itself. That seems like it doesn't matter a lot. Like you could be misidentifying high performers.
Yeah. So, right, so there, for various reasons, it could be that we are sort of misidentifying the optimal way to pair people up. Maybe somebody shows up in the data with a low score or a high score, and they really shouldn't have had a low score or a high score. Or maybe in a particular school, the way in which the evaluation was done sort of thwarts our ability to match people up. That's possible. I think that that would bias us away from finding effects. Because we would be sort of in that, you know, think of the extreme of that where everybody just gets perfect scores, we would essentially be matching people on noise, and I think that there is, as I'm going to show you, some evidence that matching them on specific skills helps, but maybe that means we're underestimating the benefits of matching.
So were teachers aware of whether they were target teachers?
I mean, I'm almost certain that they were aware. We did make an effort not to call this sort of mentor and mentee. We did make an effort not to sort of call out the sort of better or worse dimension here, but.
So how was the structure? So did everybody in school receive a
card?
No.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So both sort of, or Jim, did you have a question?
Well, I can come back to it, but maybe you want to deal with it later. But it is this issue that you've got these 19 different skills, and I'm wondering, I can well imagine that in general, you find many fewer very low-performing teachers on some skills than others.
That is true.
And then I worry a little bit about the kinds of teachers that are being selected into the experiment in this case. Well, we'll come back to whether it's appropriate or not.
Yeah, so, right, so there's some selection into the sample here, yes. And maybe there's a particular way. I can show you the table that has sort of which skills were teachers were more likely to score low on, and that almost certainly influences the results that we get in some way.
Well, and it goes to the point of whether this kind of pairing works better around some skills than it might for other skills.
I can tell you that we tried to, we don't have a lot of statistical power, but we have tried to look at this, whether the effects were bigger for particular, exactly what you said, whether people were paired on particular skills. But we don't find, but we don't expect a lot of power. Okay. To add some more detail that's relevant to Vivian's question and Sally's question. So what did we do? So the research team, that is me, created a list of recommended one-to-one matches, target-to-partner pairings for each school. So what we did was for each, you can imagine making a huge matrix of all possible pairings between teachers in a school, right? And for each of those possible pairings, we calculated a match score, which was the number of strength to weakness matches that potential pair had. And then we chose the set of one-to-one pairings that maximized the sum of that score, sum across all of those scores for the school. So back to Sally's question, we weren't randomly assigning pairs together, but they were assigned in a way that sort of was entirely based on the observation score algorithm, which we'll use. So after we made these pairings, school principals sort of took the baton from there. The school principal met with the teacher pairs, asked the pairs to work together for the school year. In those conversations, the principal was asked to talk about the goal being to improve performance in matched skill areas and to suggest activities like, for the pair, like getting together and reviewing evaluation results together, observing each other teaching, discussing strategies for improvement, following up on commitments they made to each other, etc.
When were these, so two-part question, the first part is when were
and were teachers either the partner or the target in some way, broadly speaking, incentivized to engage in these activities? The second part of the question is, can you talk a bit more about the district context, particularly, and this is much more your expertise than mine, but things like the teacher evaluation structure, teacher compensation structure, and you know, how that might affect the way that we might think about teachers in this district engaging in this,
yeah,
and generalizing that to other settings.
Yeah, in terms of incentives, there were the relatively direct incentives for the target teacher of improving their evaluations. Right? They had been matched on their evaluation score. They had been asked to improve in those areas. There was any incentive that they had to improve their evaluation score that was relevant to their participation. As for the partner teacher, our sense of the primary motivation, I'm not sure whether to what extent the school principals called this out in their conversations, but the primary motivation that we heard from the mentor teachers is that sort of they wanted to make some investment in their school community, and they have an evaluation reason to do that. There is a part of the evaluation that is where they get scored on their sort of contributions to the school and professionalism in the school more generally. So they may have been thinking about that. So those are incentives.
And just on that point, with the target, because I think it relates to the second, and the target teachers, like, are they in a setting like DCPS, are they under threat of some kind of potential dismissal, non-tenure, reduced compensation if they don't improve?
Not reduced compensation, potentially dismissal, but, you know, in practice, I don't think that there's been any dismissal. Certainly not on the order that. Treatment. So I'm
going to
shift now over to talking about the
effects.
Yeah, so.
Sorry, if you're moving on, can you go back? The silver lining, I think, of the small experiment is that you can show us a lot about the actual sample, how it shook out. I would be really interested to see something like a plot of the distribution of the match score gap, just to understand in practice. There are many different ways you could have imagined doing this. Different objective functions.
Here or here?
The set of one-to-one pairing. So I'd just be interested to see in the treated schools, it means that you had a handful of teachers with really severe gaps, and that's what happened to maximize a score, or it turns out that you've got a pretty even distribution, and it happens that you were able to find a match, a one-to-one match on the one or two areas that people were lacking. This sort of gets to Jim's question, just in practice, how does this shake out? What kind of person gets matched with what kind of person?
Yeah. I don't have it here, but my memory is that conditional on being in the set of target teachers, that the average number of skills that we were trying to match them on was about 5. So if you had one area that was where you scored below 3, which again is a very low score empirically, you had 1, on average you had 5. And then we were able to match the typical pair. These are the moments of the distribution that I do know. Typical pair, the median pair, was half of those skills got matched by. So the typical teacher had 5 skills to match, and the typical pairing had 2.5 of those.
Yeah, some kind of just shakedown of, you kind of think of the flow chart of selection into treatment.
Yeah.
If you had some sense of, here's how many teachers were in the pool to begin with, here's the fraction of them that had at least one, so fell in the bottom, and then walk us through that part.
So the first half of that is in the paper, and the second half with more details on the pairing, that could be nice. No, not anything as a result of the experiment. There are new teacher mentoring programs and things like that you might find in a typical public school. Those things
this goes back to Sally's point, but I think speak to also how, like, how many people were matched and I got their top match. I mean, because I can imagine a scenario where there might be one or two teachers who potentially could be matched a lot. You know, I mean, they're really, really good players. Like, writing this up, I mean, so I think it's part of what Sally was saying, too, interesting to see how many people kind of, like, how far away they were from their kind of their top match. Because, right, once you're matched, you're out of the sample, right? You can only be, as a,
that's right,
as a, the only part.
But that's right. Remember, we're searching over the entire space of matches to maximize the score. So it's, we don't do it sort of one at a time. We don't like try to match the first person.
Sure.
And look at what's left. But the general point is true that some people didn't have their. We can define best match in different ways, and there are probably all sorts of rich ways that people have suggestions about other ways to match people up. But on this particular criterion of, you know, did. Are you at least with someone who has some history of demonstrating skill in the areas where you need help? Like I said, about half of the teachers did not have all of their weaknesses matched off, and they certainly could have, right? There were teachers in the school who could have matched all of their weaknesses, but were using, as you say, we're using that teacher in another test.
We're
going to
really
look
that And so then, were you matching within approximate grade level or subject area in middle school? And like, to what extent was that?
No, we didn't. Primarily because we didn't have data to be able to do that. I'm going to use that a little bit later on to show you whether the treatment effects were larger for people who were matched in terms of grade level or subject. And the answer is that they were not. We can ask more questions about that when you get there.
Yeah. Regarding the match scores, so if I'm understanding the way you calculate the match scores correctly, was there any way to account for the potential that a target partner could, the partner might have a higher score on one in one category, but actually a lower score than the target on the other? So like almost like an inverse relationship thing.
I like to call these the sort of this sounds cynical, if not. I sort of call these the Goldilocks pairs, right, where like one person has a strength. There's a strength and weakness match in one direction, on one skill, and the other direction, the other skill. There just aren't that many of them. People who score high on lots of things, and so those are the primary people who are the partner teachers. They're doing relatively well. Okay. Some estimates of treatment effects. This is an experiment, so almost all of the results I'm going to show you are sort of what you would expect from the first week of a course on analyzing experiments. It's going to be the difference in the mean test scores between treatment and control schools. That's the first estimate I'm going to show you. Then we're going to break it down by the role that the teacher had in the experiment. But, you know, again, looking at mean differences in student test scores. That is not the econometric challenge in this paper. The primary econometric challenge in this paper is inference. So, and the reason is that we have a small number of clusters at which the treatment is assigned. So let me sort of set the stage by just stating that the null hypothesis of interest that we have here is that there is no effect on average. This is almost always the null hypothesis that we have in mind, and so much so that we never state it out loud, but it's important to state it here, as it becomes clear in a moment. So we want to know if there was an effect on average for schools and teachers who participated in this treatment. And the primary challenge for inference is that we have a small number of clusters, just 14 schools in this experiment. The typical approach, if you have a clustered experiment where you randomly assign treatment at the school level, would be to use a traditional heteroscedasticity cluster, robust correction for the standard errors, which almost always works, except when you have a small number of clusters. So there are two inference options that we have in this particular case. The first is the wild cluster bootstrap T, which Cameron Gellar and Miller suggest. And the other, I'll say a little bit more about each of these. The other option is to go all the way back to the Fisher randomization test, all the way back to 1935, but there's, you're looking for sort of a discussion of the Fisher randomization test in the language that, that most of us in this room use every day. The New England and Rubin book on college methods has a discussion of the Fisher randomization test. There are some strengths and weaknesses to each of these two approaches. In the paper, we show both of them. But let me just talk about the strengths and weaknesses of each of these. And by the way, this is sort of a part of the paper where your feedback is very much welcome. First of all, wild cluster bootstrapping. So this was designed with the particular null hypothesis that we all want to test, that there's no average treatment effect. And in the Cameron, Gellback, and Miller paper, it performs very well in simulations, even with as few as 10 clusters, so even smaller than the case we have. But at the end of the day, the method moves from an asymptotic argument. Even though it's designed to help out in cases where there are a few clusters, it still has an asymptotic argument. The fact that they see it performing well with a small number of clusters doesn't mean that it's always going to be the case. There's that. The other approach, the other option is the Fisher randomization test. So it's sort of famous, the Fisher randomization test is famous for, as a test for a different null hypothesis, right? And that different null hypothesis is that there's no effect at all. None of the treated cases were changed in any way as a result of the treatment. And in fact, it's an exact test for that null hypothesis. That is, we don't have to make any argument from asymptotics. We don't have to make any distributional assumptions. It's just simply an exact test for that null hypothesis. Why is that true? Well, think about what that null hypothesis means. It means that under the null hypothesis, the potential outcomes of case I in the treatment are exactly equal to their potential outcomes in the control. Treatment and control doesn't change outcomes in any way. So that's the exact null hypothesis that we're testing, and so any movement away from that is going to be evidence against the null hypothesis. So you can have some movement away from that, no effect at all, and not have an average effect. That is, you could find that you could reject the null hypothesis of no effect at all, but not reject the null hypothesis of no average effect. So how do you do this? In practice, what you do is we have these seven pairs of schools. So what we do is we calculate the treatment effect under every possible instantiation of the random assignment. So we can replicate all 128 possible ways in which the random assignment could have worked out, calculate the treatment effect. We have 128 treatment effects, and we see where our actual treatment effect lies in the distribution of those 128, and that gives us a p-value for our actual treatment effect. So all of that is great and really useful in lots of settings, but this test may be underpowered for the null hypothesis that we're actually interested in, which is that there's no effect on average. So some pros and cons to each of these. Let me just sort of show you how this works out in practice in this setting.
Before you, you can either punt on this question until you get to the conclusion question. But in turn, I mean, inferences, is sort of the name of the game here. And, 14 or 7 treatment control is a little bit of a challenge. And everybody, sort of, again, school level or district level always becomes a tough unit of analysis. Do we have evidence that, And I think I could maybe come up with a way that there are indeed spillover effects within schools, you know, so if you didn't believe there were spillover effects within schools and there were some pairings that you could have done but you didn't do, you could have a different research design at the teacher level, potentially.
Yes.
Is there, can you help me understand, I mean, I guess you could sort of test for spillovers in the control school.
Yeah.
Are there ways to relax this constraint of the school as effectively the...
Yeah. I think I will show you.
That you could convince somebody of who might help.
So within the data that we have, I will show you what I think is the best we can do within these data, and that is to look at teachers by the role that they were assigned, which is... Both shows that, you know, it is not the case that we only have 14 data points.
Yeah,
right?
No, I mean, it's...
We do have some variation within schools that I think, is not, you know, strictly randomly assigned, but I think it's consistent with a sort of broader story and adds more evidence to the conclusions that we're drawing here. Maybe that's the best we can do. Within these data, you'll see all of that today. And there's also, I think, the best test that we can do today for spillovers, which is to look to see whether there was any treatment effect on the teachers who were left out of this entire day. Some teachers who just didn't have, weren't target teachers, they weren't part of the teachers, they were just in school. And then the other thing is to promise some future paper, which is this year we're doing.
The difference is those community schools and that effectively puts it back into
teacher level or like it's it sort of deals with it sort of says the story
happens across sort of
so the prior average test scores for the school is an incredibly good prediction of the variation, which I'll say more about in a second. I don't know. So we're definitely benefiting from that. I don't know if there was.
So, right, like the main sort of design effect that you're getting.
Yeah, so let me just get to the results since we're sort of talking hypothetically about what's here and just show you, sort of start to show you, I think, start to get to Vivian's question, but also just to show you how inference can be very different in this case. So what am I showing you in this table? First of all, the outcome here is standardized student test scores in reading and math pooled together. The first row is just the difference between school average in the treatment school and school average in the control school. So just comparing treatment and control schools, we're getting a treatment point estimate for the treatment effect of about 0.06 or 0.07 student standard deviation. Column 1 has no right-hand side controls. Column 2, except for it has fixed effects for each of the school pairs. But column 2 has adds a vector of pretreatment covariance, which is primarily student test scores, but other characteristics of the student. So actually, I'm showing you here regressions that are done at the student level. You can imagine, to Vivian's point, sort of doing this at the school level and that's in the paper. But the general pattern holds the same, which is that we're getting generally more precision, a lot more precision, by controlling for prior test scores, which is almost always the case in these kinds of experiments, but it's definitely the case for us. Okay, what else do we have here? The first two rows of p-values here are just showing you that the traditional approaches would certainly reject and are likely to over-reject. So heterozygosity robust errors, these are very small p-values. We also get small p-values just with the traditional cluster correction. And the last two rows are the two approaches to inference that I've mentioned. So the first row, the third row is the wild cluster bootstrap T approach. And the fourth row is the Fisher randomization test. So, we would reject school level difference in treatment effects. We would reject it so something like a 10% level if we were using the wild cluster bootstrap T p-values, but we wouldn't reject at anything conventional if we were using the Fisher randomization test. As a general rule, the randomization inference tests are going to be more conservative in the sense that the p-values are going to be larger. And so for the presentation today, both of these approaches are in the paper, but for the presentation today, I'm just going to show you the randomization inference p-values. But it is also the case that for a given alpha level, like, you know, if you want to reject for a p-value less than 0.05, or you want to reject for a p-value less than 0.1, if that's your criterion, that when you reject with the randomization, with the exception of this table, when you reject with the randomization inference, you will also reject with the wild cluster bootstrap T. So you should get whatever your preferred alpha level is, you should get basically the same result, even though the p-values will generally be a little bit bigger.
Two questions on the outcome details. Are the test scores standardized within this sample, in the district, in the state?
In the state.
Okay. And then, am I in the sample if I was in a treated school but not in a paired classroom?
Yes. Okay. So, so far what I've showed you is just the average difference between treatment and control schools, and there isn't, which is about 0.06 or 0.07, and there isn't any sort of especially strong evidence that difference is statistically significant at conventional levels. That's the first result. But I think definitely was the case before we started the experiment that we expected the treatment effects, to the extent that they occurred, to accrue primarily to the target teachers. That is, our whole motivation for doing this was to help improve the performance of the teachers who were relatively low performing. So now I want to show you treatment effects by teacher role, that is to look to see what effect the treatment had on target teachers separately from their partners, separately from a third category, which was teachers who had no role in a partnership at all. I'm just going to replace the single treatment effect indicator with, in our estimating equation, with treatment interactive with role, which was known ex ante. And the important thing to keep in mind here is that that we know who would have been the partner and target teachers in the control school. That is, we did all of the matching process, which was entirely driven by an algorithm and their prior evaluation course. We did all of that matching process before we randomly assigned schools to treatment and control. So in the control school, I know who would have been the control, the partner teachers, and the target teachers. So when I show you the treatment effect for target teachers, the comparison is between target teachers in the treatment schools, the average outcomes for their kids, and target teachers in the control school, not all other teachers. So here are those results. Again, we've got the first column without baseline covariates and the second column with the covariates. So for the low-performing target teachers, here's the 0.12 that I mentioned before. That is, students who were assigned to target teachers in the treatment school scored 0.12 standard deviations higher in reading and math than did students who were assigned to target teachers in the control schools.
This may be in the paper. Is there a covariate balance table that assesses whether principals reallocated students to treated or paired teachers as a consequence of the treatment?
So there are there is discussion of that point in the paper. Long story short, there's just not, there just really wasn't any scope for them to be able to do that, given the timing of how we did things, but also we do some empirical tests.
Yeah.
And,
is there any work that would evaluate the readings into the math test scores?
Yes. Not in this version of the paper, in earlier versions of the paper, we had at least one table showing math and reading separately. The math results were a little bit bigger than the reading results, but both were, they sort of had similar patterns as supposed to be said.
So I totally understood that you don't have the data on the kind of substance of their interactions, but even just anecdotally, what was, how frequently were they meeting at all, seeing each other's lessons? Because the devil's advocate is really getting at what we should infer is the treatment, right? Devil's advocate is how much of it could just be it being made more public within the school who the low-performing teachers are, and so there's a increase in effort just to that signal or that label that has nothing to do with the substance of any of the interactions. I know you can't say it definitively, but I'm more curious about your sense of what's driving this.
Yeah, it's possible that there was some effort margin that arose because the low-performing teachers were sort of outed. That would not be consistent with the results I'm going to show you in a moment that show that the treatment effects were larger when more of part of the teachers still were matched. And some other sort of similar results. So,
and on the first point around like how frequently, anecdotally, what they're doing, the time they have together.
Yes. So our efforts at collecting systematic quantitative data on that front were sort of met with information technology challenges in the school. That's another day's discussion. So we have some information from interviews that we conducted with teachers during the course of the year, but I'm not remembering off the top of my head specifics of like they met every, you know, 2.3 weeks or something like that. But they generally reported doing the things that I was mentioning before. Of course that could be what they were reporting to us. But they told anecdotes about particular, you know, I was in this teacher's classroom observing and I saw her do this and that like changed the way that I did it. So, you know, not a lot of evidence on what they did, but it seems consistent with what we do know seems consistent with what we have.
Just looking for
a lot of
information here. Your standard error shrink by like a factor of 9 for the low performing target teacher, it's more like a 30-40% reduction in other cases. And I'm just looking for intuition, and I wonder if maybe just plotting some points would help to understand what's going on. My guess is that there's sort of huge variance in the outcomes for these low-performing.
More variance. More variance and potentially baseline test scores are a better predictor for those classrooms.
Or the more conditional variance left that is. But I don't think there's anything wrong. It'd just be interesting to know
why we're doing so much better. Sort of almost has to be some combination of things you mentioned, right? It's probably more variance in outcomes and bottom of the distribution. That's year one. I'm going to show you now a table with outcomes in year two that's going to look similar. These results are going to, I forgot to mention, somebody was asking about spillovers. So here we also have estimates for teachers who are partner teachers or didn't have an assigned role. Yeah, this is the best evidence that I have about questions about spillovers, which isn't a lot, but is what it is. So the point estimates are positive, but they're not statistically significant. You could have in mind some people have in mind in the past a much more complex story where, say, the high-performing teachers are actually made better off by participating, but they're also giving up time in their own classroom, so there's some negative treatment effects and some positive treatment effects for them, and the net of that is something small and positive, but that'll be good.
Sorry, there's a question about the treatment effects. So the control schools, the principals don't know about the matches, or do they know about the performance on these different
So this is their formal evaluation.
So they do know about
they
that.
They do know
the
about that.
Do know that. But then on the treatment side, not only do they have the matches, the principal and whatever staff is also aware.
Yeah, the principals should be aware of the evaluation results for their teachers. You know, but yes, the control schools didn't know anything. So here's outcomes in the next year, the year after treatment. So we're following the teachers, not the students. So we follow the teachers to the next group of students they were assigned to teach, and we look at the same kind of comparison, comparing student test scores, standardized student test scores in math and reading. So on average, between treatment and control schools, the treatment effect is a little bit bigger, but you know, getting less statistically significant, how much sort of weight you want to put on that. For low-performing teachers, again, there's still a positive treatment effect, which is that it can't, you know, that would be consistent with the conclusion that it's not entirely effort, that they are continuing to score better. But it's not using the randomization inference approach. It's not anywhere sort of near the conventional level. This is actually turns out to be one case in which the wild cluster bootstrap t-values are much lower. But again, I don't know how much weight you want to put on that in that particular case. So positive point estimates, but not significant at conventional levels. Here, that's year two. There is some attrition of teachers from the experiment, and so we do a rebound style approach to testing for attrition. still find positive effects, but still not significant.
I understand why you might go down that route, but to the extent that that's a downstream consequence of the treatment, you reduce attrition by empowering people in their job. I'd be happy to bake that into the treatment effect.
Yes, we don't find differential attrition either out of the school or out of the district.
Yeah, I guess what I'm saying is I don't see the motivation for the leave outs thing. It's like it seems like if attrition is a consequence, that's a consequence of the program. It's a school level treatment.
No, that's true in some broad sense of the treatment. I mean, I think people, you know, to the extent that you're focused particularly on using, say, the second year outcomes as a way to test the hypotheses about sort of changes in skills versus changes in effort. Like, you might want to try to focus in as much as you can on keeping the sample the same. I mean, from the perspective of a school principal who's trying to make their school better, okay, right? I agree. Like, all of this becomes potentially part of the positive or negative effects of the intervention. But, okay. All right. So let's. We're about two-thirds through, so we have some time to talk about potential mechanisms. So just to put some structure on thinking about potential mechanisms, I've listed sort of three categories here, things that might be causing the treatment effects that we saw, borrowing here from Bojack's and LI improvement in three categories, but applying them to our particular setting. So the first category is skill growth, that, you know, the low-performing teacher learns new skills from their high-performing partner. A second category is increased effort motivated by this partnership. Now, they already had some motivation to increase their effort because they were getting low evaluation scores, But it could be that there's some marginal increase, and what Eric was mentioning, sort of maybe being having more of their evaluation scores revealed, or Ben, I guess, was mentioning, maybe having more of their evaluation scores revealed encourages them to work harder. A third category is that perhaps the partnerships were an opportunity to sort of work together in production, to share resources or to share tasks. Things like we might have sort of coordinated on writing lesson plans. I didn't change my skills, didn't change anything, but now I have some better lesson plans to work with. So, you know, I'm not going to be able to perfectly rule in or out any of these three categories, but I think they are three plausible categories that you could think about when trying to sort of form your own opinion about what gave rise to these treatment effects. I can show you some results, some empirical results from the data that I think begin to help think about these different margins. And they're all going to, most of them, with one exception, they're all going to take, those empirical tests are going to take the following form. I'm going to have some characteristic of the pairing, which I've called C here. I have some characteristic of the pairing, which existed before the treatment started. And I'm going to look to see whether the treatment effects co-vary with that characteristic. So were the treatment effects bigger or smaller when the pairing had characteristic effects? So the first one, for example, one characteristic is the proportion of the target teacher's weak skills that were matched by the partner teacher's strong skills. That's the first one I can show you. And just testing the data whether the treatment effects were bigger when that proportion of skills was matched skills was larger. And again, remember, probably to reiterate the point too much, remember I know this also for the control tool. So the comparison here is between treatment and control target teachers with similar characteristics of the pair. So here's a table with lots of results, but starting with column one. So we've got the average treatment effects for the target teachers up on the first row. That's like the one I showed you before, controlling for pre-treatment characteristics. And then what we've added in column one relative to the estimates I showed you before is this interaction between the treatment indicator for target teachers and the proportion of skills matched. So what does the 0.056 mean? It means positive. So it means that the treatment effects were larger for teachers who had target teachers who had more of their skills matched. So for the average target teacher, the treatment effect was, for the average target teacher, the treatment effect was 0.13, but it was larger for, if the proportion of your skills matched was one standard deviation above the mean for the distribution of pairings, then your treatment effect would have been something more like, closer to 0.2. Okay? So it's going to turn out that this is the primary result, so the p-value here is 0.125, sort of dangerously close to something that we would call statistically significant at conventional levels. We can get a little bit more power by just making a binary comparison between pairings that were above the median in terms of the proportion of skills matched and pairings that were below the median. That's a little bit more power, and it looks like most of the treatment effect is coming from, here again, it looks like most of the treatment effect is coming from pairings where most of the target teacher weak skills were matched. So 0.036 is like the effect for pairings where there wasn't, where there weren't a lot of the weak skills matched. So that's sort of the basic result. Now let me show you some variations on that theme that speak to some of the questions that have been raised already. So one question that's been raised already is,
so maybe it was that that the target teachers are just they have more room to improve. They have more things they need to work on. Maybe it's just the case that that's where the treatment effects were largest. Maybe because, as Ben was suggesting, this information about them was revealed to the public, so we can look to see whether the treatment effect covaried with the following measure: the number of skills we attempted to manage. That is, the number of low, the number of out of 19 of those low scores that the target teacher had. And the treatment effect doesn't move around with the number of skills that we attempted to match. In fact, if anything, it might be negative. We can put both of them in at the same time, the number of skills we attempted to match and the proportion that we actually did match. And again, the proportion of skills that we matched is dominating the number of skills that we matched. So there are other results, and there have been other versions in prior versions of the paper that are similar, where at the end of the day, the thing that dominates is the proportion of skills matched. And as I said at the outset, this implies a very particular kind of complementarity in the production of learning from your coworkers. But we could step back and just ask, has sort of Eric sort of led us down, the path that he wanted us to go down? Could we just step back and say, are we really just saying things about good and bad teachers? So in columns 5 through 8 is where we're going to sort of try to give you some evidence on that question. So in column 5, what we're going to do is we're going to interact with the treatment effect just with the target teacher's own private prior value added score and the partner teacher's prior value added score. And the treatment effects don't seem to be co-varying with the general level of performance that the target and partner teachers have. We can, in column 6, we can keep those same covariates in and add the interaction between the target teacher's prior value added and the partner teacher's prior value added. And the basic idea behind columns 5 and 6, again, is just to ask a much bigger question, which is this really all about sort of good and bad, generally, teachers? And if we from a practical perspective, you could imagine that the principal, school principal's version of this question is, should I just take the best teacher in my school and match that teacher up with the worst teacher in my school, and the second best teacher and match them up with the second worst teacher? If that was the right approach, just match the sort of generally good and generally bad teachers, we would have expected to see the treatment effects co-varying with prior performing teachers. That's not what we see. In fact, I can keep those controls in the regression and add back in the proportion of skills matched. And again, the proportion of skills matched is the thing that predicts variation in the treatment effect.
So, I have a question about outcomes. And I know there are lots of reasons for that. Not for me, but since the treatment was focused on teaching skills,
yes.
So, what is that going to be?
I'll show you that in 2 seconds.
Okay.
Yes. And then I will tell you why you shouldn't do it.
Great. Okay. I have a question.
You may end up signing you off.
I have maybe a redundancy, but I also think building out of intervention, I think you look at the degree to which specific teaching practices will more part of the student value added impact be or not, because it might not just be like the discussion earlier, like about the specifics of the match. Like certain of those ranking schools might have no, we might not have thought that there would be a
Yeah. In short, the pattern is pretty much what I've always seen when looking at the correlation between classroom observation scores on a rubric like this and student test scores, which is, any one of these, you know, if you run a bivariate regression between student test scores and one of these skills, you will find a positive correlation. But when you put all 19 skills on the right-hand side, an individual regresses. So it's hard to make any sense out of it because they're highly correlated. Okay. So, you know, so we take this as evidence consistent with the conclusion that it's not just about matching up sort of good employees and bad employees, or good high-performing teachers and low-performing teachers, but that the treatment effects came in particular through matching people on the specific skills that they either needed to make improvements in, or skills, in the case of the partner teachers, where they had some benefit to contribute to that partnership. Which again is I think is an important result and implies a very, thinking about the problem of a school principal implies a very particular way of going about matching people up if you wanted to do this in your school. Okay, let me show you a couple of other results about potential mechanisms. So I mentioned this before, we can do the same kind of thing where we look to see whether the treatment effects were larger or smaller for other characteristics of the pair. So in column one here, we're going to look to see whether the treatment effects were larger when the teachers were teaching the same subject. That is, if they were both teaching reading or both teaching math. And the treatment effects are, the point estimate is positive, but not statistically significant.
For all elementary teachers, just considered all teaching the same subject?
So they had to actually have been assigned to students who were taking math or reading tests. So in some schools, there might have been teachers who were specializing, even in the early grades, in math or reading. So no difference in treatment effects, apparently, based on whether or not you were teaching the same subject. The other column is looking to see whether teaching the same grade level changes the treatment effects, and again, the point estimate is positive, but far from statistically significant. So these things could have been contributing. We don't have a huge sample here, so these things could have been contributing to the treatment effects, but the primary thing that shows up again and again is this dimension of skill and strength and weakness matching between teachers. Okay, now to get to Julie's question, which is, so far all of the results I've showed you are student test scores in math and reading. And this next slide is going to switch for one slide to show you results about teachers' performance as measured by their classroom observations after the treatment. So, the simplest thing to do is to take the average score across all 19 skills and look to see whether treatment improved scores on classroom observations in general, and that's column number one. I've broken it out here by the three teaching roles. So for low-performing target teachers, their classroom observation scores went up a little bit, but not statistically significant. Same thing for the high-performing target teachers. Not really any evidence of shifts on this overall average score. But then we can take these 19 skills and we can look at we can group them up in, I think, what is a reasonable way, given the experiment, and that is columns 3, 2, 3, and 4. So first of all, we calculate the teacher's score on their post-treatment observations before the skills that we actually matched them on with their partner. So we take the set of skills where we actually made a match, calculate the teacher's post-treatment score on those skills, then we do the same thing for skills that were not matched, but where we tried to make a match. So these are things where they were scoring low, and we tried to match them with a partner, but we were unsuccessful given the algorithm's rules. And then the last column is skills where we didn't make any attempts to make a match. So these are things where the target teachers were scoring relatively low. And the pattern is suggestive that, again, the treatment effects are coming through cases where we're matching target and partner teachers. So there's a big positive coefficient for the matched skills, not a
not anything like that, an order of magnitude smaller and far from statistically significant for the skills that were not matched. And if anything, negative, though, a p-value approaching one for the skills where we don't fit in any terms of matching. So, let me give you one reason why you should be slightly skeptical of these results, which half or more of you are already thinking, which is that these outcomes are the scores on which we matched teachers, and the principals were well aware of what we had matched the teachers on. The principals were well aware that they were participating in an experiment where the goal was to improve performance. So if you want to be very skeptical, you could say this is all sort of an artifact of principals giving teachers higher scores in the areas where they were hoping that they would get higher scores. So you have sort of optimists and pessimists poles of the continuum here, and you can decide where you lie on that continuum and sort of how you use this information. But I think it's at least consistent with this conclusion that the mechanism was about matching skills in some way.
Sure, sensitive to the fact that you probably don't have the sample size to look at this, but again, getting back to this issue about on which skills teachers got matched, and that there might be some higher prevalence in some skills, could you then specifically look at the achievement outcomes of kids for those specific skills where there was a high density of matches to understand whether these results are primarily coming from some skills but not others, where teachers might find it easier to improve?
Yeah. So I will tell you what we've done, and then I'm definitely open to suggestions about other ways we could try to get at this. So what we have done is we've broken it up by that those 19 skills they put into three big categories, which are sort of like generally classroom management and instruction and something else, which I don't remember. And there is variation between those categories in the degree in which people are scoring high and low. And so we look at whether your match was a, whether you, the skills we matched you on were about classroom management versus whether we, the skills we matched you on were about instruction. And you don't find statistically significant differences across those, across that dimension. To go all the way down to like, into, you know, trying to do a regression with all 19 of those skills broken out, but I don't think we're gonna, get, you know, much given the power. But maybe we will be able to say more about that in the near future now that we're randomly assigning things to do.
Who designated the categories for the different skill groups? Did you guys do, run a factor analysis and determine which skills loaded into those categories, or if they loaded well into them, or were you just told?
Yep. An excellent question from somebody who has probably used data like this before. So these, the thing that I just mentioned in response to Jim's question was to use the categories that were predefined by the people who wrote the rubric. The factor analysis generally lines up with two categories, instruction and classroom management. But that could be because they were already before. So I don't know that we would find much different if we proved it about factor analysis, or we can try.
I'm just thinking that some questions, like we've done this before, and some questions that people think would fall into a specific domain, they just don't have a high loading, and when you take it out, you could see like a better relationship between them. But again, like, yeah.
Oh, it could be. Yeah, not right yet. Okay. So, we have about 10 minutes left. There's nothing on this slide that I haven't told you before, but this is sort of my takeaways from the paper. First of all, before we even get to sort of the details of mechanism, I think the results are encouraging that we find these sort of meaningful improvements, economically, educationally meaningful improvements in student outcomes. By doing something that is a
a relatively straightforward sort of management practice, encouraging coworkers to learn from each other. Most of what we've been talking about is about mechanisms, and I think that, just to reiterate sort of my takeaway, which is that the pattern suggests that the target teachers learned skills from their high-performing partner. And the evidence for that is these particular way in which the treatment effects show complementarity and skill matching. Stepping now further away from the data, you know, I think this is an inexpensive and apparently effective alternative to traditional professional development programs and products. Inexpensive in terms of budget, for sure, and potentially inexpensive in terms of the opportunity cost of teacher side. So both things are important things about in terms of professional development. And we also think that this kind of intervention is a complement to new teacher evaluation programs. To the extent that we have some hope that teacher evaluation programs will help people improve, it seems insufficient to just simply give them scores. At least to me, it seems insufficient to simply give them scores to tell them how they're doing today. It would be, I think it seems intuitive that it would be better to provide some sort of support to help them improve. And this seems like it might be a reasonable way to use those evaluation data to help make those improvements, to help make those sort of supports. That's all I wanted to say. But thank you, and I'm happy to hear other comments or questions in the last 10 minutes.
When teachers receive their scores from the principals or whoever is doing the evaluating, do they just receive their scores? Are there any comments that they receive when they get them?
Yeah. My memory is that they're supposed to receive some kind of feedback. There's structure for feedback. I couldn't tell you much about the content of
Okay. Of
those.
Okay.
I was just wondering, I didn't see a lot of, maybe I missed it, information about the experience level differences between the teachers that are effective versus those that are ineffective being matched. Like, is this, I mean, another story in my mind is that perhaps we're just seeing very experienced teachers improving low experienced teachers, and then you've got sort of this long run feasibility question.
Yep. The treatment effect is not covariate. Either the level of experience for the target teacher or the difference in experience between the target and the partner teacher. Partner teachers are generally more experienced, but that experience, overall experience, does not seem to explain the treatment. There's a question
there. So going back to that concept of matching teachers on the subject of matching teachers at grade level, I was wondering if and maybe the sample size is not large enough to understand this, but I'm imagining the treatment size might actually, or the treatment effect might actually be limited, at least in part by teachers who are not teaching or that they would see reading or mapping in any way, shape, or form. So I imagine the Spanish teacher who is the target teacher who may improve actually significantly over the course of the collaboration, would that improvement not be tracked by checking the reading and mapping? Is that
true? They're not in there. There were some in the experiment, but they wouldn't have been in any of the tables that I showed you today. Because they didn't have tested outcomes, and because I restricted the last table to teachers who were in the sample. Yeah, but it's possible that they had, you certainly heard anecdotally from art teachers and PE teachers that they felt like they were better off as a result of participating, but we don't have any
I want to circle back to something you said in passing to Sarah pretty briefly. Since you do a very nice job of laying out the choices, the practical choices you have to make with the inference, I'd be very receptive to seeing the within school grade OLS. So So just, you know, knowing what we know about how particularly in low-income schools, principals may be underutilized student-teacher matching within grade, just a regression in among the treated schools of student outcomes on was your teacher treated or not, controlling for school grade fixed effects. So just imagine students are as good as randomly assigned within school grade. And then if you show me that that is stable to adding student covariates and that the point estimate sits right about where you're, and you know, you've got the placebo test from the others, it would bolster and it could work.
I agree that it would. I'm skeptical of it because test scores, baseline test scores are just, you know that they're sorting on baseline test scores.
In some settings, in some not. I mean, I've seen there are definitely schools where they're not, and there is, just from looking at the quick demographics you gave us of the district, in chaotic schools, often less.
Yeah.
I mean, you could imagine seeing a huge bump up in the R squared, but and even then, if we think, I mean, we have compelling evidence at this point that we think student exits do a good job of mitigating selection bias.
Yeah. No, we could totally do it.
Yeah.
And I see the sort of the logic.
I mean, it seems like we've done all of this work with MET and, you know, all these other things to validate value added. I feel like now we should get as much as we can out of that machine.
I guess, like, just anecdotally, like, if you went on UPU, like, do you think that, I mean, it seems not just that, just about, mostly about failures, but is a piece of this also working with peers, sort of, like, I don't know, like, having the peer supervisors, and sort of, like, the idea that the person who's helping you is a peer versus, like, I don't know, you could, like, two people being different ways that you, like, inject failure development into the school, so in your
with
like that, a piece of it, or
to
get
you to reject,
like,
the skill or style? I don't have any empirical tests here that we only work with in school. I think there's some relevant evidence. First of all, there are other kinds of one-on-one sort of coaching interventions for teachers, which also show positive effects, which suggests that it can't entirely be something about working. In those interventions, it's some external person, not an individual. So that suggests that it can't entirely be something about working with someone individually. But on the other hand, my reading of literature on formal coaching programs, especially for new teachers, is that there can be sort of larger positive effects when you're coached by someone who used to work in the same school or works in it, like that knows, or that in other ways knows the environment, which would suggest the other side of the coin, which is that there probably is some benefit to having working with somebody who sort of knows the kinds of kids, maybe even the specific kids that you're working with. But we can't. It seems plausible, but especially given other evidence, like we can't look that out. I was trying to exercise the skill of letting there be silence. So we have to.